हेलो,
दाय
हाय
एवरीथिंग एवरीथिंग
हाय। सो वी आर गोइंग बैक।
हाय निकोल, कैसी
हेलो हेलो बैक बैक।
हाँ
हम टेक नोट बैक।
निकोल ओ
ओ
दखन तक मी
कैसी
मुराई सुन दाई
ओ
अब मेरा ना
सो गोइंग बैक। सो एवरीबॉडी इन Everybody are
Yes,
in now?
everybody.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I was asking you, what is the basic function of a nursing aide?
Goodbye.
Okay, if somebody will ask you now, why did you take up this nursing aide course? So what are the basic functions that you will provide to a patient if you are going to study a nursing aid course? At the end of this course, or at the end of what we are going to study here, the nursing aid, so we are the basic function. You have to remember this. Basic function of a nursing aid is to provide the activity of daily living, ADL. You have to memorize that one. You have to keep it in your mind. The basic function of a nursing aide is to perform and to provide the ADL, activities of daily living.
Daily
And that
living.
includes the bathing, the feeding, aiding in mobility,
Okay.
taking of vital
Washing
signs,
the toilet, bathing.
bathing, feeding,
Pressure.
all of these things
Okay.
are the basic function of a nursing aide. Okay, got it?
Again.
Okay,
Okay.
madam.
So now we are going to the second lesson for today. We have the fundamentals of nursing aid. And this is it, the activity of daily living, ADL. If someone will ask you, what is ADL?
Activity, daily
Activities of daily living. Okay,
living.
fine, good. So this is the answer. And this is your basic, and this is the fundamentals of a nursing aid. So going forward, we have to study the fundamentals of the nursing aid. This is your basic functions. Again, I will repeat it again and
Again.
again. The basic function is ADL. And number one is the vital signs. We are going to measure the vital sign. We are going to, a vital sign for everybody know, everybody know. A vital sign is a clinical measurement, specifically pulse rate, temperature, respiration rate, blood pressure, that indicates a state of patient's essential body functions. Not only those four, we have seven. Okay, so it is the important component of a patient care. Before seeing a doctor, before establishing a treatment, vital signs should be taken first. A measurement of the vital signs should be taken first. It is an important component of patient care. So they determine which treatment protocols to follow to provide critical information needed to make life-saving decisions and to confirm feedback on treatments performed. So accurate documented vital signs are a very important baseline to determine patient's condition. Okay, so now we are going to discuss what are the 7 vital signs routinely monitored by medical professionals such as the nursing aide, the healthcare providers, which includes the following. We have 7. Number 1 is the body temperature. Number 2 is the pulse rate. 3 is the respiratory rate or the respiration rate, which is the rate of breathing. Number 4 is blood pressure. It is considered as the vital signs, but it is often measured along with the vital signs together with the oxygen saturation, the weight, and the height. Okay, so now we have 7. So remember that we have 7 vital signs to take whenever a patient is coming to a medical healthcare facility or you are going to take care of a patient, you are going to check or to monitor, to measure the vital signs of a patient. Number 1 is vital sign. 2, we have the bed making. This is one of the ADL. This is one of the function. We have as a part of the housekeeping, it is a part of our duty and responsibility to make the bed of the patient. And this is the bed making. It is the act of arranging the bed sheets and other beddings on a bed to prepare it for use. Just imagine when you get up in the morning, you are preparing your bed after you sleep from the night, right? So the same thing, we are going to prepare a bed for the patient. But this time, we are in the nursing aid. We are the nursing aid, so we will prepare beds or we will make up beds according to the condition of the patient. So it is an important nursing technique to prepare various types of bed for patients or clients to ensure comfort and useful position for a particular one. So we are going to make a bed, okay? So it is act of arranging the bed sheets. It is how you do in the morning when you get up from the bed. You are fixing your bed. So this is the same way as we are going to make a bed for the patients. But in a hospital setting, we are going to prepare a bed according to the condition of your patients. So we have the types of bed making in the hospital. Actually, we have 8. So now we have the simple bed or unoccupied bed, admission bed, or a closed bed. This is number 1. Number 2, we have the open bed or occupied bed. Okay? Closed bed or occupied bed. Number 1, I repeat it again, it is an open bed or admission bed or simple bed. Okay, the number 2 is closed bed or occupied, means to say there is a patient. So it is closed and occupied. Number 3, we have the cardiac bed. Cardiac bed means this is used for those patients with a heart problem. Fowler's bed. This bed is a kind of bed wherein the patient, you are going to make a bed for a patient who is in sitting position. And a medical term is a Fowler's bed. Fracture bed. Fracture bed is a bed which is, we are going to make it for the patients who are having fractures. Those patients who have broken bones, those are called the fracture bed. We have the operation bed, anesthesia bed, these beds we are going to make for those patients who are coming in after surgery, after operation. Patient mobilization. This is one of our duties and responsibility as a fundamental basic function of a nursing aide. We have to aid in patient mobilization. Mobilization means moving. We have to aid in patient mobilizing, moving. Okay, those patients, most of our patients are going to be bedridden. So they will not be able to walk. They will not be able to walk properly, stand properly. So we have to aid. We have to provide them assistance. We have to support them when they walk. We have to support them when they go to the toilet. So this is a patient mobilization or mobilization. And early mobilization and sitting out of bed will increase the blood flow in the patient limbs and internal organs of the body. So it promotes the increase of blood flow and the mobilization, it helps the blood flow inside of those internal organs. It increases the blood flow and removing the pressure on the limbs. Limbs means those hands, those legs, they are the limbs. And other parts of the body, and can also prevent bed sores from developing. What do you call the bed sore is? They are the sore. They are some redness at the back of your patients. So be careful. That's why we need to mobilize them. We need to position them. We need to move them to avoid or to prevent the bed sores from developing. Ambulation stimulates circulation. Ambulation means walking. So we are going to support, to assist, to promote patient, to provide patients help, assistance, supporting in ambulation, in walking. So it helps stimulate circulation, which can help stop the development of a stroke causing blood clots. Okay, so we need to let the patient, to support the patient, assist the patient to move, to ambulate, to walk, because to prevent them from developing of the stroke causing blood clots. And walking improves blood flow, which aids in quicker wound healing. So poor moving and poor handling, it is a practice that can lead to back pain and musculoskeletal disorders, which can lead to immobility or inability to walk. They will become weak. If those patients are always on the bed, if the doctor says the patients can move, so we have to help, we have to assist, we have to support those patients to ambulate, to walk. And by doing so, those patients who are unable to walk for themselves, we have to provide them ambulatory devices. What are those ambulatory devices? They are the walking aids, the tools to help them, or devices that helps them to move, that helps them to walk. They are orthotic devices used for support. Augmentation, enhancement of the muscle action. They help the patients promote the augmentation of the muscle action and reduction of weight-bearing load. It maintains stability and balance with the aim of transferring individual or patients from one place, from ambulatory, from going to walk, difficulty from one point to another. So you are going to assist, you are going to support those patients unable to walk properly. So with the help of ambulatory devices, you will be able to promote blood circulation and lessen the difficulty of walking. You will help out your patients to walk. Here, I'm going to show you the mobility aids. We are going to know what are those ambulatory devices or the walking devices, mobility aids, we are calling them. So they are walkers. If they are familiar to you, they are walkers. There are canes, crutches, manual and electrical wheelchairs, and motorized scooters. So walking aids, they are tools. They are designed to assist walking or enable mobility. Zimmer frames and wheel rolling walkers or rollators are other devices designed to assist people having difficulty of walking. So now in these photos, I will show you, or you can see in your screen, we have here on the left, we have crutches. They are being used of by the patients who cannot walk. Okay, so they are going to walk by the help of the crutches. Elbow crutch, if only one side of the body is unable to, if the legs is unable, one side of the body, one side of the leg is unable to move, so they are going to use or support them with elbow crutch. Walking canes, most of our elderly or most of the elder people, they are walking with the walking canes because they help them, they assist them, they aid them to walk properly. Zimmer frames, they are the one with the rollers and they can help in pushing. So they will not be able to make an effort to walk, because they are going to be helped by the Zimmer frames where they are having the rollers. Rollators is another kind of mobility aids, and they are going to be helpful for those patients who are unable to walk. So all of these are the mobility devices or the ambulatory aids that you are going to use for the patients to help them to walk, or if they have the difficulty in walking. Number four is the patient's safe handling or the manual handling. Moving and handling is also known as manual handling. So in this case, it is our responsibility. It is all of the nursing aid responsibility to manually handle our patients. Like in lifting, we have to lift our patients. We have to push our patients. We have to pull them. We have to maneuver. We have to rotate. We have to let them stand still. We have to carry them, and we need to transport them. So all of this manual handling, we have to know the technique. It is not about the lifting that we can just lift them. There are processes, there are techniques that we need to know, we need to study, we need to do it. So accordingly, by doing all of this. So these are the photos of the lifting, the repositioning, or the fundamentals of nursing that we are going to do to help them in moving. So we have the lifting and transferring. This is how we are going to lift. We are going to transfer a patient once we are already in actual place of work. Okay, so just imagine what we are talking about now. This is how you are going to be in the future once you are once you have done with the course. So this is what you are going to do when you are already in a healthcare facility. So we need to lift the patient. We need to transfer from one bed to another. We need to transfer the patient or lift the patient from the bed to the wheelchair. We need to know how to push, how to pull the trolleys, how to maneuver the patient, rotating them from bed to the wheelchair, and we have to know the technique of carrying them. So all of this in an actual. In the lesson 3, we are going to do all of this actual, lifting, actual pulling, actual maneuvering of a patient. So you have to show me. I'm going to show you first, and then you have to return demo. So we are going to grade you accordingly. We are going to assess your skills in how to do it all. So you will be ready when you come to an actual work, in an actual workplace, that you will be competent, that you will be able to perform all of this by yourselves or with the help of others if you will not be able to handle it alone. Enteral feeding. So we have come to one of the activities of patient daily living as enteral feeding. So one of those is feeding, right? Either we have to support them, assist them in feeding orally, or we are going to perform an enteral feeding for them. What is enteral feeding? Enteral feeding is to give food to supply with nourishment. But enteral feeding means the intake of food via the gastrointestinal tract, okay? So the GI tract, gastrointestinal tract, is also gas digestive system or the GI tract. Digestive system or the gastrointestinal tract. So enteral feeding is the feeding by the use of tubes. So we will be the one to provide patient feeding by the use of the tube. Okay, so it will be passing through. The food is going to be fed to the patient by a tube, through a tube. So the GI tract is composed of the mouth, the esophagus, the stomach, and the intestine. Okay? So it is new to you. What we are talking about now, if you are in a medical field, it is new to you. So it is difficult for you now to understand or to digest what we are talking about. But later on, as we go through, as we finalize or as we complete our nursing aid course, we are going to digest all of this. We are going to be ready to perform our basic functions as the nursing aid. So the main types of the enteral feeding tubes, you have to know that there are many types of the enteral feeding. And as I said, enteral feeding is feeding by the tube via the gastrointestinal tract. Okay? That is clear. So number one, the type of enteral feeding, we have the nasogastric tube. We are calling it NGT. This is the abbreviation for the nasogastric tube, NGT, okay? It starts in the nose and it ends in the stomach, okay? So orogastric tube, OGT, it starts in the mouth. Oro is the mouth, okay? Naso is the nose. That's why in the nasogastric tube, the feeding via tube starts from the nose to the stomach. And orogastric from the mouth to the stomach. Okay, clear? Nasoenteric tube, it starts in the nose and ends in the intestine. So it includes nasojejunal and nasoduodenal tract tubes. So oroenteric, when we say oro, it means through the mouth. The tube is passing through the mouth. If it is naso, from the nose. So oroenteric tube starts in the mouth and ends in the intestine. Gastrostomy tube, it is placed through the skin under the skin to the abdomen, going straight to the stomach. It is called the percutaneous endoscopic gastrostomy. It is called, abbreviated as PEG tube. Most of the patients that we are going to take care of, we have the NGT from the nose to the stomach. We have the gastrostomy tube or the PEG tube from the skin to the abdomen, straight to the stomach. And jejunostomy tube is placed through the skin under the abdomen, in the abdomen, straight to the intestine. But mostly, most of the patient that we are going to take care of, they are having either nasogastric tube or the PEG tube. Only these both are mostly the common feeding that we are going to encounter, or we are going to feed our patients in our nursing aid career. Okay, so going forward, so we have learned that we have six types of enteral feeding. And enteral feeding is feeding by the tube via the gastrointestinal tract. This is how it is. This is the picture or the photo of how the enteral feeding is. From the enteral feeding, you will have a feeding through, inside of a bottle or inside a plastic container, and it's going to pass through, starting from the nose, if it is nasogastric tube, going directly to the stomach, that is the nasogastric tube. So we have the gastrostomy. If you will find here down is the gastrostomy. So that is the point where it is directly going to the stomach, PEG tube. So we have the nasoduodenal, the nasojejunal, and the jejunostomy tube. So all of this feeding are by the tubes. Okay, so going to the parenteral, this is the parenteral, and we are going to talk about what is a parenteral feeding. So parenteral feeding is called PN or intravenous feeding. It is a method of getting nutrition into the body through the veins. Okay, so we have the enteral feeding by a tube and parenteral feeding by the veins. Okay, it is intravenous feeding into the body through the veins. So depending on which vein is used, and this procedure is often referred to as either total parenteral nutrition, or the one that you have seen that is hanging, that is the TPN, or the total parenteral nutrition, or peripheral parenteral nutrition. So parenteral nutrition or the parenteral feeding or intravenous feeding, it includes, what includes in that bottle of feeding? So it includes carbohydrates, it includes fats, minerals, carbohydrates, electrolytes, vitamins, other trace of elements. For patients who cannot eat or cannot absorb enough food through the tube feeding or by mouth to maintain good nutrition status. So this feeding is by the intravenous in going into the going into our body through our veins. So if you will see here, now you can find here the differentiation or the comparison between the parenteral feeding. Oh, sorry. What is in the parenteral feeding? So this parenteral feeding, as I said, is the intravenous feeding. Alam nyo yung nandun sa mga nakaswero? Those people, those patients who are having the fluid they are similar, but it is not like that. So this feeding is only going through the vein, the big vein on your shoulder, in the clavicle here, next to your shoulder. Okay, there is a big vein here wherein the tube is going into that, going to the whole body. I mean, the nutrient is passing through the tube by the vein. Parenteral is intravenous feeding by the vein. Okay, and on the right side, you can see that the parenteral nutrition here, this is the kind of feeding that we are going to provide patients through their veins, through the intravenous feeding. Housekeeping. One of the tasks or one of the roles and responsibilities as the basic function of a nursing aide is a housekeeping. I did not say that you are going to be housekeepers. You are not housekeepers. Again, I will say you are not housekeepers, but it is a part of your job as a part of your nursing aide role to clean up, to be a housekeeper in the same area where the patient is. So it refers to the duties around the hospital, keeping your patient room clean, changing the sheets of the patients on the bed, mapping up skills in the patient care areas, in the waiting room, is safely removing medical domestic waste from patient care areas. So means to say, when we are going to dispose, when we are going to throw our garbages, we will know that as a nursing aide, we have different disposals. Where are we going to dispose of the waste products that we are going to produce or generate inside our hospital or our healthcare facility or in a patient care room? So it is important to create a peaceful, infection-free, and pleasant atmosphere required for the speedy recovery of the patient. How many of you, if you are going to be hospitalized, or if you have been in a hospital and you will find that your bed is very dirty and your surrounding is not clean, it's not tidy, everything is not organized, do you think you will be healed? Do you think you will recover soon? Definitely no. So it is one of our nursing aid role to keep our environment clean, peaceful, infection-free, pleasant-free for the patients and the staff, as you are the nursing aid staff, to clean it, to promote healing of our patients. So the purpose of general housekeeping is to reduce the number of microorganisms that may occur in contact with patients, visitors, and staff. So we are minimizing. We want to be infection-free. So in the hospital or in a medical center, we're in so many diseases, so many illnesses, so many people, especially now that there is a COVID pandemic. So mostly of these healthcare facilities, they are going to be infected. We don't know those people coming in are infectious. We don't know whether those people are COVID carrier. We don't know. So we have to create a clean environment, an infection-free environment. So now down here, so I'm showing you the different photos of what you can observe, what is inside of a medical healthcare facility. So where we can dispose or where we can throw our medical waste or the waste that is being generated in a hospital. Number one, as you can see on the first to the left, we have the medical waste. They are called medical waste. We are going to discuss about all of this, but just right now, as a housekeeping, we have to know where we can dispose our waste in the hospital setting. Number one, you can see here, in this bin, in this yellow bin, it is a medical waste. If you can see a yellow bin like this, in a healthcare facility, it is a medical waste. All of those waste product that is being used by the patients or you as a nursing aide used in contact with the patients, you are going to throw it in a medical waste. Remember that, medical waste. You see the logo there? It is biohazard, it is toxin, it is infectious. That's why there is a logo like this. So domestic waste, if we say domestic or general waste, they are the normal waste. Waste like papers, waste like ball pens or anything, office garbage, they are the domestic waste. They are in a black bag or they are in a black bin. Sharps containers, we have the container where we can put all the sharps, anything that has pointed, anything that is has pointed edges, anything that has sharp edges. So those knives, those scalpels, those needles, those vials, those ampules, anything that can cut, anything that can pierce, you can put in the sharps container. Clean linen trolley. You will find the clean linen trolley because this is where we can find all those clean linens that we are going to use when we make the bed of a patient. So it is in one linen trolley. We have the dirty linen hamper. To the end right, it is the dirty linen hamper. So when we are going to change, we are going to change the soiled or dirty linen or the dirty beddings of the patients, we have to put them directly inside of the dirty linen trolley. Okay, remember the housekeeping, this is our role. Hygiene and grooming. Why did we say that it is a part of our fundamentals or basic function as a nursing aide to provide hygiene and grooming to our patients? The same way as I told you, you are doing it personally to yourself, right? Before you, after you get up from the bed, what you start to do? You have to bath. You have to make your brush. You have to brush your teeth. You have to comb your hair. So all of those are kind of grooming, hygiene. You are going to take a bath. You are going to brush your hair. So all of those are hygiene and grooming. It is a part of your basic daily living activity for your patients and your the families. So we have come to the end of our second lesson. It is the fundamentals of our nursing aid. So, okay, so what we have learned from these fundamentals of nursing aid that we have discussed. So you know now from the beginning, I was talking to you about the basic function of the nursing aid. And that what is that basic function of the nursing aid? Can anybody answer?
Vital signs.
The ADL, mom.
Yes,
basic you are right. The ADL.
Okay. And what consists of all those ADL? What is ADL?
Activity daily living.
Activity daily living.
Okay. Fine. Good. That is